Good evening, everyone. I want to welcome you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to our Tabernacle Baptist Church New Bridge Bible Study Series, Learning Lessons from a Great Cloud of Witnesses in the Bible. Let's pray. Let's have a minute of silence to put aside everything we have had in our lives and ministry. Especially as we've been in time of time and season of Easter and the Holy Week, we really should focus on Jesus. Father God, we love you and adore you. And without that heart of love toward you, we are approaching to your throne of grace with our hunger and thirst and desire to know more about you through your word of truth and life. Father, we thank you for this season of Easter. And during this season of Easter, people in the world use this Easter time for their own holiday. Their time to enjoy, indulge, pleasure of the world. But you, God's people, come to God's house to study your word and pray together. So, Lord, we ask you to bless all our brothers and sisters who have been so faithful to you and to your church. And as we are studying those people in the Easter story in the Bible, may your Holy Spirit speak to our heart and open our eyes to see Jesus and experience true meaning of cross and resurrection, so that when we pass this season of Easter, we won't go back where we were before, we won't go back to normal, but we'll be better instrument, and we'll be true disciples of Jesus with a stronger faith to serve you better, and serve your church, your kingdom, for your glory. Lord, we remember and pray for those who are suffering. Shine your light of healing upon those who are suffering. And put your loving arms around those who are mourning. And strengthen them with your love and grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I was praying, Lord, what should I share? We are in the Holy Week. I felt it would be good if we study Word of God, something appropriate for this Holy Week and the season of Easter. So today we are studying the lives of people in the Easter story, and we will study Judas Iscariot, that very pleasant story, and then Simon of Cyrene, and then criminal on the cross, centurion at the cross, and Joseph Arimathea, Nicodemus, Cleopas and in his company, and the woman at the cross, and the empty tomb of Jesus. Now, during Easter time, we should focus on Jesus. But we must not miss what God is speaking to us. Because there is a reason why they are there in the Bible, isn't it? So may the Lord bless us all through all their stories in the Easter story and strengthen our faith and hear the word of God at the same time hear the voice of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm reading a few passages. The first one is from Matthew chapter 27, verse 1 to 10. Early in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people came to the decision to put Jesus to death. They bound him, led him away, and they handed him over to Pilate, the governor, when Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned. He was seized with remorse and returned the 30 silver coins to the chief priest and the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood. What is that to us? What is that to us?" They replied, "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. The chief priest picked up the coins, and it's against the law to put this into treasury, since it is blood money. So they decide to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That's why it has been called the field of blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 silver coins, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. The next passage I'm reading is from Gospel of Luke chapter 23, verse 26 to 49. Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verse 26 to 49. As they led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourself and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the barren women, the wombs that never born and never bore, and the beast that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if men do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and on the other on his left. Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.' And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, 'He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one.' The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, 'If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself.' There was a written notice above him which read, 'One of the criminals who hung there hurled insult at him.' 'Are you the Christ? Save yourself and us.' But the other criminal rebuked him, 'Don't you fear God?' He said, 'Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong.' Then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' Jesus answered him, 'I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise.' It was now about the sixth hour. And the darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things. Next one is a little bit short story, John Gospel chapter 19. John's Gospel chapter 19, verse 38 to 42. Interesting story about Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jews. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with a spice in strips of linen. This was in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid, because it was the Jewish day of preparation. And since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. The last Bible reading is from Gospel of Luke chapter 24, verse 1 to 35. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like a lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the man said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hand of a sinful man, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the woman, because their word seems to them like a nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and then he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Now the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" is still, their face is downcast. One of them named Cleopas asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had a hope that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but did not find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow heart to believe all that the prophet has spoken. Did not Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scripture concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It's true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. May the Lord bless and honor the reading of his word. Amen. What an exciting and fascinating story that is. And with all that in this amazing story, shall we just go through two questions? First one is about Judas Iscariot, and the second question is all about in all other people we see in the Easter story in the Bible. The first question is, on the day Judas Iscariot decided to follow Jesus, I have no doubt that his heart must be right. But then let he betrayed Jesus and ended his life in a tragic way. What went wrong with him? What went wrong with him? And what kind of lesson should we learn from his life stories? Is there anything we can learn? Yes. We can learn from life story of Judas Iscariot. What went wrong? And it can be my story. The second question is, what common ground do you find from stories of Simon of Cyrene, a criminal on the cross, and the centurion, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus, Cleopas and his company, and the woman at the cross of Jesus and his empty tomb? Let's look at our first question. On the day Judas Iscariot decided to follow Jesus, his heart must be right. Surely, surely. That's why Jesus took him as one of the 12. But then he betrayed Jesus. And as we all know, he ended up his life in a tragic way. So what went wrong? What was downfall of Judas Iscariot? And what lesson should we learn from his life stories? We all know Judas Iscariot, the symbolic name for betrayal, isn't it? When somebody betrayed me or and people said, "You are Judas Iscariot. You are Judas." But it makes us wonder, was it like that from the beginning? Was Judas Iscariot was like that from the beginning? You know, if we look at the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verse 4 to 6, it says, "But one of the disciples, Jesus' disciple, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected." This is from the story when Mary broke alabaster jar of pure nard, so expensive perfume, and the poor and Jesus. This is what he said. "Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages." He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, as keeper of the money bag. He used to help himself to what was put into it. See, in a way, in our context, at present time, Judas Iscariot was like a treasurer in the church. Yeah? He was looking after all the finance, all the monies. We assume that, Jesus, he did minister in the people with his 12 disciples, and we all see that, humans follow him. At least those people, there must be, some of donations from people, offerings, when they're healed and when they see all the miracles. So there was someone who need to be in charge of handling all that money. So, may I ask you, can you ask someone who you can trust to look at your money? No. As I said to our leadership, I personally believe in order to be someone serving the church finance, the person should be at least in the church 3 to 5 years. Need to show their faith and their consistency and faithfulness and integrity, especially. There's no way Jesus allowed him to be in charge of a keepers of money bag. There's no way other disciples will agree if they're suspicious on him. He must be one of the very, very faithful one among the 12. Judas Iscariot. He was money keeper for the ministry of Jesus. Means that Judas Iscariot, very sincere disciples of Jesus, so was chosen to serve the money bag for the ministry of Jesus. Then we immediately will have a question. So what went wrong with him? From where he went wrong? I pray and pray and try to find a key verse from the Bible, and this came to my heart. A verse from 1 Timothy, Apostle Paul's first letter to Timothy. chapter 6, verse 10. Shall we all read it together as one voice? 1, 2, 3. For the love of money is a root of all kind of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Amen. When I heard this verse, thank the Lord. This verse really hit the nail to answer the question. What went wrong with Judas Iscariot? From very faithful, trustworthy disciples among the 12. If we try to, study this a verse from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10, Apostle Paul says, some people eager for money have wandered from faith. This is what we can see exactly, isn't it? Judas Iscariot, a sincere disciple of Jesus, so became treasurer of Jesus' ministry. Then this is what we heard from John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 6. He did not say this, as he said, in public, criticizing this Mary who broke alabaster jar of nard perfume. What a waste! Can't we help poor people if we don't waste this pure nard to help others? He said, not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He used that money in the money box. Should it be used for Jesus' ministry? But help himself. Use for himself. It shows this fact. So, according to what we just heard from John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 6, Judas Iscariot already had stolen money from the money bag of Jesus' ministry before his betrayal. What do you think about this? You know, I'm not sure whether this saying makes sense for you. In Korea, we use a lot of this saying, he that will steal a pin will steal an ox. So someone steals small things, and if they continue to steal, it will become bigger and more serious and more serious. Do you have something like that in Wales? Anything? Jeff? Is that? But it's true, you know what? When I read an interview of a notorious, very well-known thief in Korea, because he ended up with one occasion he broke into the one of the most richest people in Korea. He stole like millions of pounds with all the jewelries and then diamonds, sapphires and cash. And later, of course, he was imprisoned. And when he was released from the prison, he gave interview. It started from his childhood. He began to steal small things. Nobody caught him, and then he did a little bit more and more and more and more. Don't you think this shows how the sin our life can work, isn't it? If we abandon small things, it's all right. Then we commit a little bit more sin, more serious. When we look at Judas Iscariot, when he was stealing the money from the money bag of Jesus' ministry, probably when he did for the first time, probably he was like, ooh, what should I do? If you know, Jesus found me, you know, find me to doing this, what should I do if other people find me? Then nothing happened. So it become like his habit. Probably he started like a steal, like a once couple of in the small coins, a little bit bigger and bigger. And then he ended up doing this. When he saw Jesus kept talking about how he would be arrested and suffered and die. Hang on. I have spent my life 3 years to follow him. But rather than he give us all the promise, okay, you will be at my right hand or left hand, or you will be like a something like prime minister, ministry of education of my kingdom, whatsoever. He just keep talking about he will die. I need to get repayment. I need to get compensation for my 3 years of life to follow Jesus. I don't want to take it as a waste of my life. So as you've seen, he ended up to make a deal with these religious leaders who are seeking to kill Jesus and made an agreement to sell him with the 30 silver coins. And this is another very famous scene, isn't it? Judas' kiss. Not holy kiss. If you look at the Paul's in the apostle, I remember, to the earliest Christian, greet one another with a holy kiss. But this is Judas' kiss. Sign of betrayal. You know, this reminds us this. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith, isn't it? Judas Iscariot. You know, obviously, as we see from other disciples' story, he must have left everything behind to follow Jesus. That's something we shouldn't just neglect that. That's why he was chosen as one of 12 disciples. Even among those 12 disciples of Jesus, he was chosen to look at the money back of Jesus' ministry. But he eager for money, not for kingdom of God, not for Jesus. He eager for money. That's why he wandered from the faith and pierced himself with many grief. That's what we see from the in the story later. When you realize, when Judas Iscariot realized himself, oh dear, what have I done? What have I done? With a great regret, when he tried to bring the money back, with raising his voice, he's innocent. He hasn't done anything wrong. That's too late, isn't it? That's too late. You see, this is the things we see in the Bible. I share with you that we all agree, though we dearly love the Lord, as we're still living in flesh, we still fail, we still fall, we still commit sin. With our Lord Jesus Christ's love and patience, our Lord will wait for us to repent. But we see, I share with you about King Saul's story. But as we commit sin again and again and again, probably we cross over the line. We see when people commit sin again and again and again, God's time is over to see the face of a God of love. Then we will see the face of a God of justice. That's what happened to Judas Iscariot. And you know, whenever I read Judas Iscariot's story, really, it really breaks my heart to see how this faithful servant of God, because he loved money, he eager for money, not for Jesus, not for eternal salvation, not for God's kingdom. He wandered from faith and how he destroyed himself and ended up his life in tragic way. Make me wonder, what if, when Judas heard this from Jesus at the Last Supper, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." What if Judas is cut, kneel down before Jesus, "Sorry, Lord, that's me, forgive me." What if, even when Jesus spoke to him, "What you are about to do quickly." What if Jesus was still talking to him? "I know what you're doing. I know what you've done." If he repented before Jesus and did not betray him. Have you ever thought about it? Of course, as Bible says again and again, God showed no favoritism. Once God promised one thing, it applied to everyone. As we see from Apostle John's first epistle to early Christians, chapter 1, verse 9, "If we confess our sins," amen, "He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." Amen. I have no doubt. If Judas Iscariot, when Jesus spoke to him clearly, "Judas, I know what you have in your heart. Judas, I know what you've done. Judas, I know what you're about to do." If he fell before Jesus, and if he repented, "Lord, I'm sorry. My eyes have been blinded by the money. I would love money more than you. I'm sorry. That's why I have sold you for 30 silver coins. Forgive my sins." I'm sure our Lord Jesus would have done this, as his word promised. Then I know some Christians who believe themselves know the word of God in the Bible will ask, "Well, if Jesus forgave Iscariot as it happened in that way, how Jesus would have died on the cross and rose from the dead?" And even I heard, some Christian ask this kid, "Did God make a Judas to betray Jesus?" Of course not. Please, You know, Judas betrayed Jesus with his free will, according to his sinful nature. That's why Apostle Paul warned the early Christian again and again, and again and again, we must resist the devil. And we must confess our sin. Amen? And we must crucify our sinful nature and passion. That's why we need the full armor of God. Amen? Helmet of salvation. Breastplate of righteousness. Belt of truth. And the gospel of shoes of peace. And shield of faith. So we can quench the flaming arrow of Satan. And we can defeat Satan's temptation with the sword of spirit. Amen? The word of God. As Jesus showed the best and the perfect example when he was tempted by Satan. He defeated Satan's temptation. It is written, it is written, it is written. You know, this is what exactly God did. I was amazed while I was preparing this Bible study. When you look at in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, this is what Joseph said to his brothers, yeah, who actually lied again to him. His father, Jacob, didn't say that, but because they're afraid, you know, whether they would get revenge from their brother Joseph now, who is prime minister of this superpower nation and kingdom Egypt. Or, you know what, our father, you know, actually, you know, when he died, he made a will. You know, you shouldn't like bring independence to us. And this is what Joseph said to his brothers. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Amen? I was amazed. I could make a sort of imagination. If Judas Iscariot, after he finished his life such a tragic way, if he stand before judgment seat of Christ, I think if Jesus said this, what Joseph said to his brother, it really worked. You intend to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Praise the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, do you still want to do to Judas Iscariot like that? Are we willing to humbly take this Judas Iscariot story into our heart as a warning? If I'm not careful, I can be like a Judas Iscariot. Amen? You know, when I sit down with my wife and my children, and when we do our family duty, I often send myself and encourage my children, my wife, to the same. Let's not just do. This can be my story. If I'm not spiritually waking up, if I don't examine myself through the word of God, use the word of God as a mirror to look at myself, whether I'm eagerly looking for Jesus or money or worldly things. If we seek something else than Jesus, if we do not seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and if we seek for something from the world, worldly pleasure, we can be another Judas Iscariot in this world at present time. So may the Lord bless us all and help us to humbly take Judas Iscariot's story with our self-warning, it can be my story. If I don't come to feet of Jesus day by day, amen? Continue to fix our eyes on him and follow him. We can be another Judas Iscariot in this world at present time. Because of time, I will go to the next question. You know, I love this. You know, when we read the Bible, we can focus on all these, you know, well-known, you know, figures such as Peter and Andrew and 12 disciples, and then, you know, Pontius Pilate and all these. But there are some of the people who are mentioned very shortly. But there are a lot of things we can learn from them. And then also, though they are all, they all have different name, all different story, we can also see common ground as well. This really came to me very, very strongly. This when I was praying for this Bible study. So what common ground do you find from the stories of Simon of Cyrene and the criminal on the cross, asked Jesus to remember him, the centurion at the cross, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus and Cleopas and his friend, and why not the woman at the cross and the empty tomb of Jesus? Let's look at the story of Simon from Cyrene. This is what we see from Mark chapter 15, verse 21. Actually, you know, Gospel of Mark, in this, you know, records about Simon from Cyrene in most detailed way. And then Mark says this, a certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they, Roman soldiers, forced him to carry the cross. As I pointed out, why? Because Jesus was already beaten, and Jesus was already flogged, bruised, and cut, and shedding blood already. Where is the siren at present time? That's like a northeast part of Africa, something east part of in Libya, like that. And this is interesting things to remember. You know, many biblical scholars believe that Mark most likely wrote this Gospel of Mark while he was in Rome for Roman citizens and the Roman Christians. But this led with Romans chapter 16, verse 13, which the letter Apostle Paul wrote to Christians in Rome, greet Rufus. So remember what Mark says. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Chosen in the Lord. And his mother, who has been a mother to me too. You know, the amazing thing is, Simon of Cyrene, who was forced to carry the cross of Jesus, he didn't volunteer, didn't it? Probably he must be grumbled. Probably when this Roman soldier, hey, you come here. You look very strong man. You carry the cross for him. Because he can't just carry the cross anymore. You may say, why? No, I don't want that. You come here. Probably, isn't it? Because the Bible tells us Roman soldiers made him to carry it. Sometime, you know, whenever I read this story of Simon from Cyrene, it reminded me some of the moment I didn't want to carry the cross, my own cross. Yeah. After I heard, I read, I preached how many times, Jesus asked, if anyone would come after me, they must deny themselves and carry their cross and follow me. Have you been always willing to carry your cross? If you say, you have my respect. To be honest with you, many times, oh, Lord, why? People in that Korean pastors and the missionaries prayer meeting in Swansea, we have once a month, they all laughed. When our Lord, it was early morning, I was praying. I said, our Lord calling me to organize this Korean pastors and missionaries prayer meeting. Guess what was my response to that? What? Why? You have made me so busy. What on earth? I didn't want to carry the cross. Among the Korean pastors and missionaries, we always said, there is one group of people in the world most difficult, most complicated. They are pastors and missionaries. Have you been always willing to carry your cross? I haven't. But the important thing is whether I really wanted or I felt forced to carry my cross. As long as you have carried a cross, our Lord will remember that and bless us all. Amen. This is what we see from Simon of Cyrene. His son Rufus, chosen in the Lord. Wow. And his wife, well, there's no more story about what happened to him later. His wife became like a mother to Apostle Paul. We thank you for the cross of Jesus. And we thank you for our cross. Our Lord asked us to take it up and carry to follow Jesus. Amen. Amen. How about the criminal and the cross? You know, if you look at the historical record, a criminal on the cross was one of the worst criminals in the society. So it means that this criminal did something horrible, one of the worst crimes in that society. But interesting is this, when you look at the Matthew chapter 27, verse 44, it clearly says both criminals, right and left side of the Jesus and the cross, another mistake in the spelling, they heaped insult on Jesus. They heaped insult on Jesus. However, something happened to one of them. One of the criminals was changed, saying to another, we are punished justly. We deserve what we should get. We get what we deserve to get. But this man has done anything wrong. This man has done anything wrong. Then this is what he said. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Amen. Wow. What an amazing miraculous change happened to him. When he was on the cross, when he was crucified in that pain, incredible, just unbearable pain, he heaped the insult on Jesus with his another criminal on the side of the cross of Jesus. I believe that Holy Spirit touched him. And on that cross, he was completely transformed and realized that, yes, I and that another criminal on the side of the cross of Jesus, we are receiving what we deserve for the terrible thing we have done. But this man, Jesus, has not done anything wrong. He's truly Messiah. That's why, you know, one day while I was reading this, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom, I burst into tears. You know why? Because I remembered this one man in the hospital, in the bed, dying. It was Kingston Hospital. I spoke to this man. Family was not sure whether he was conscious or not. He was hearing or not. And I asked him, I shared the gospel message. And I appealed to him, look, if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, because the family said he didn't, please move your finger, your head, whatever, your feet, toes. That really moved my heart. Family were amazed. I know then there are some more people who always have a twisted mind and said, probably that's some accident whatsoever. No, I don't think so. Family was amazed. Actually, there was a movement. I believe that this, our Lord allowed this story being written, our Lord allowed this man to come to Christ and have a salvation. There's reason why. To encourage us, to share the gospel message to the end of, even to the very last point of people's life. We should do our best to share good news of Jesus. Amen? That's why I really value the chaplaincy in the hospital. I always thank them. Whenever I see them, oh, thank you for your wonderful ministry. Even the very last minute of this horrible convenience life, when he asked Jesus, please remember me when you come to your kingdom. What did our Lord Jesus said? Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Amen? You will be with me in paradise. I know I have had how many Christians came and spoke to me. Oh, I will pray for my father, my mother, and my children, and my husband, my wife, and my grandchildren. How many years? There's no signs or whatsoever. That's what we need, faith. Amen? That's what we need, faith in the Lord. As the Bible says, faith is being sure of what we hope for. Amen? certain of what we do not see. If we believe because we see, that's not faith. That's not what Bible tells us about faith. I thank God with all my heart. And Heron and myself, my children, we pray for my father-in-law's salvation. How many years? When God's time came, though it was tragic, he had this massive stroke. And the Lord 70% of his sight. He lost his sight, but through that, he received eternal life through his faith in Jesus. Pray the Lord. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Today you will be with me in paradise. Jesus will say same thing to anyone who come and then accept him as their personal Lord and Savior. Even very last second of their lives. Amen? We should never give up. How about the Roman centurion? This is another remarkable and amazing story, isn't it? Wow. You know what? When you look at what happened about the passion of Jesus, he went through all the sufferings and the mockings and shames. Well, this centurion could be the one who led the mockings and the flogging on Jesus. Well, at least abandoned his soldiers to do such a horrible thing to Jesus. But he definitely orchestrated Jesus' journey to Calvary and his crucifixion. He was the man who led all these Roman soldiers to crucify Jesus. But don't you think it's amazing? After Jesus took his last breath, thank the Lord, as I just shared with you, before he took last breath, he had this, one of the criminals received eternal life. But after he took last breath, as he died on the cross, the first one who was saved was the centurion who orchestrated the crucifixion of Jesus. That's amazing, isn't it? That's amazing. There's no limit and there's no restrictions for people to come to Christ. Gospel of Matthew and Gospel of Mark clearly speak to us. As soon as Jesus took the last breath on the cross, and then this century, so what happened? He said, surely he was the Son of God. Amen. We are heading to the end. How about the Joseph of Arimathea? This is what the Bible tells us about Joseph Arimathea. He was a prominent member of the Jewish council, so he was high up there in the Jewish society. And the Luke's gospel tells us in that Sanhedrin meetings, and he did not consent to crucifixion of Jesus. That's brave, isn't it? And he was waiting for the kingdom of God. But one thing interesting we see from John's gospel about Joseph Arimathea is he secretly followed Jesus because of the fear of the Jewish leaders. But don't you think amazing? Yet he found the courage to ask Pilate for the body of Jesus. You know how dangerous it was? Because anyone who followed Jesus will be excommunicated. But Bible tells he boldly, amen, asked Jesus' body. But there was someone who helped Joseph Arimathea, isn't it? Who was that? Nicodemus. Oh, right. I remember Nicodemus was probably John 3:16. It came up from Nicodemus conversing with Jesus. That's true. And John's gospel record about Nicodemus like this: the man who earlier had visited Jesus when? At night. Why? Why? Because he also feared of the Jewish leaders. But after Jesus died on the cross, this is what the Bible tells us. Joseph of Arimathea went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Amen? Boldly. Boldly. Mark chapter 15, verse 43. What a difference, isn't it? What a difference. How about Cleopas and his friend? Well, there are some different opinions, but because Bible doesn't tell us, we don't know who that company of Cleopas was, isn't it? But many people, scholar, well, assume that it was Cleopas and his wife or just friend. So if you like Google the image of a Cleopas and then his friend or company, you will see some of the painting shows Cleopas and the woman, as many people assume, the wife. And you see, as you see here, like the man and man, it's not important. But this is important. If you read in this, Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, you read it carefully, you will find something clear fact that Cleopas and his company, they knew exactly what happened to Jesus with his suffering and death. And even he heard the testimony of a woman who heard about the resurrection of Jesus. But they didn't believe it. That's why, though Jesus asked the woman, actually, to come to Galilee, actually, they're on the way to Emmaus. Even they'll not be able to recognize Jesus. While Jesus was walking with them, talking to them, well, in a way, Bible tells us they were kept from recognizing Jesus. But this is something I preached in the past when I studied what all other commentators says, and then what I see from the Bible and with the prayer. You see, our unbelief blind our spiritual eyes. I believe this is the lesson we should learn. When we don't believe, we don't see Jesus. Isn't it? So they did recognize, though Jesus, the risen Savior Jesus, was walking with them, talking to them, they didn't recognize it's Jesus. But when they reached at the village of Emmaus, and Jesus, he seems to be innocent, he will just go his own way, go further. So they urge him to stay with them. And at the table, can you see in this painting? There's a woman, company of Cleopas. As I said, that's not important things. who was the company of Cleopas. The importance of this, Jesus just tell them, come on, when are you going to believe? And he opened the scriptures, and then he just taught them from the, in all the prophecies and Moses. And then when Jesus took the bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to them, their eyes were opened. But Jesus disappeared. And then when after they realized it was Jesus, risen Jesus, and then after Jesus disappeared, they said one of this, were not our heart burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scripture to us? Amen. May the Lord bless us and make our heart to be burning. Amen. When we read God's word, and we will hear voice of Jesus, as we are all in the sheep and the flock of Jesus, we will hear our good shepherd, great shepherd Jesus' voice, and our heart will be burning. Amen? When was your last time? I have to ask myself. Your heart was burning when you read the Bible. When was your last time you really felt Jesus speaking to you? That is important. Whether the Cleopas company was his wife or female or male, it's not important. I saw one comment really talk long. I don't want to know. That's not important. Then what happened? Their face was downcast, as Luke's gospel speaks to us, because they didn't believe. And even they didn't, because their spiritual eyes were blind, they didn't recognize Jesus. They looked like a loser. When they should truly celebrate, if they believe, you know, wow, yes, Jesus has risen, he's alive, they should be all the moon and celebrating, probably having party, because they didn't believe, their face downcast. That is what exactly we see in our Christian life. Because we don't believe, we all look so miserable. Ooh, why my life is like that? And people in the world, if they see, you know, we Christians miserable life, they will never want us to come to church. Because they don't want to be miserable like one of them. If we truly believe, as our gospel said, be joyful always, amen? Pray continually and give thanks to God in all circumstances, because this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus, amen? When we believe, we can be truly joyful always. Give thanks in all circumstances, even the time of suffering. Lord, thank you for this time of suffering. Because of this, I recognize my weakness. That's why I can come to Jesus all the more. Pray the Lord. What a transformation. This loser looks, this Cleopas in his company. Downcast like that. After they met Jesus, Bible tells us they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. Can you imagine how they're so joyful when they're running? Wow! Jesus has risen. Jesus has risen. We have met him. I can't wait to just give testimony to other disciples. They're running with joy because they met Jesus. Amen? This is really the last woman at the cross of Jesus and at that empty tomb. We all know in the ancient Jewish society, women were despised. As we know, the biblical fact is that there are some of the, it's like Jesus fed 5,000, something like that. You see that the women were not counted. Around the 5,000 men. But they so faithfully, actually also these women are from the Galilee, but they so faithfully served and followed Jesus. We see that. Bible tells us. Shame on you, all your disciples. When Jesus was at the cross, well, it was only John, isn't it? Where are all other 10 disciples? After Judas Iscariot, he ended up his life. Where are the 10 disciples? They're women following Jesus. You see, when the people found the Peter warming himself around in the fire, when people recognize you must be one of them, you must be Galilean, what sort of a fear he had. So he denied Jesus 3 times because he could be dragged and he can be crucified. But this woman followed Jesus, even to the cross, even to the tomb. One thing really I still can't say is, where were you disciples? After Jesus was buried, and when Jesus needed to be buried, where were you? Why Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus buried Jesus? This woman, though they don't mention often, just a few times, if you see that, God bless them because of their faithfulness. And honor them to be first witness of the resurrection of Jesus. Amen. As they heard from, they had encounter with this angel. And they heard that, why are you looking someone alive among the dead? He's not here. Jesus has risen. He's alive. Wow, praise the Lord. They are the first one. Witness of the resurrection of Jesus. Among them, Mary Magdalene, who used to be 7 demon possessed. She was honored to be first person to meet the risen Savior Jesus. Amen. Not Peter, not Andrew, not John, not James. Mary Magdalene, who used to be 7 demon possessed, was honored. You know why? Because even after all those women in the company, they heard the good news from the angel. She was still there. She left alone. She's still there. She cried and looking for Jesus because she dearly loved him. And our Lord honor her all the more. And so she's recorded in the Bible as the first person who had a real encounter with the risen Savior Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, what are the commonness we can see from all these people in Easter stories? This is the common ground. Jesus changed them, changed their lives with amazing blessing. Amen? No matter what they did in the past, no matter what sort of miserable life they had, as Mary Magdalene was one woman who was possessed 7 demons, when they met Jesus, Jesus changed their lives, and then Jesus blessed them. Praise the Lord! That's not only their story. That's our story, isn't it? Today, while I was preparing this Bible study, I prayed the Lord with all my heart once again. Because it happened to me too. How Jesus changed my life. And yesterday, while I had on myself, having lunch with the one Korean missionary, my wife kept and said, oh, You won't believe what he was like in the past. But he doesn't want to go into detail. He doesn't want to boast his terrible life, but only our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, him to be crucified. Amen? That's our story too. That's why we should celebrate Easter with all these people's life story. Let's read it together, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, with our joyful heart. 1, 2, 3. If anyone is in Christ, they are new creations. The old has gone, the new has come. Amen? Pray the Lord. So forget about the past. Forget about all the shame and all the hurt, all the tears. Jesus doesn't want you to live in the past. Jesus has made you as a new creation, and Jesus will make you every day. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercy never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. Amen. Do you know, brothers and sisters, I have to go for June meeting for our summer back within 10 minutes. I can't stop singing because my heart is filled with joy. It's not their story, it's our story, amen? So my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this is the last slide for our Bible study this evening. So during this Easter time, shall we be in Jesus Christ, amen? Though we are in the world, we are in Christ. With reading his word, reading and meditating his word, and then pray, and then go into deeper place with Jesus. And then we will continue to praise him and worship him. At the same time, we will continue to witness for Jesus. What a wonderful Savior Jesus we have. He's not dead, he's risen, he's alive, and he is our Lord and Savior and King. Let's give all glory to Jesus. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Let's pray. Father God, what a joy we have in our heart. Thank you for all these people's life story. We have heard how their life was changed, how they're blessed because of Jesus. Lord, that's our story too. So we give all the praise and thanks and the glory to you. May your Holy Spirit come upon each one of us and help us treasure up all this wonderful story of a people's transformed life by Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then we will continuously read your word, meditate your word, and then we will continuously pray and have a deeper relationship with you and worship you in spirit and truth. But at the same time, come Holy Spirit, empower us and make us true witness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for your church, your kingdom, and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give honor, glory to Jesus. Praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you all. Shalom. Shalom. Shalom.